G'day, it's Bill here from Optics Central. Today we're unboxing some stuff. We've got something that comes in two boxes here. It's an AstroSeeker 15075 by Saxon. Now the Saxon 15075 comes in two boxes. This box here has got the Newtonian reflector in it, and this box here has the mount and the legs and some other bits and pieces in it. Now the Saxon AstroSeeker 15075 is a slightly larger sized Newtonian reflector telescope. It's set on a computerised go-to mount. That's a relatively light mount. The AstroSeeker 15075 is primarily sold as a second telescope. It would suit people who've graduated from their first refractor telescope or from a simple Newtonian reflector. The thing about it is it's a deep sky specialist. It's designed for larger, dimmer objects, preferably ones that you'll have to go out to the country to see. But it's great for those. The telescope is also good for an introduction to lunar photography particularly, but you can also do a little bit of planetary work with it. It doesn't have a very long focal length, so you're not going to get a large image of the planets. Now, before we get into unboxing it, I'm going to talk a little bit about specifications. First of all, the scope. This is a Newtonian telescope, which means it's got a parabolic mirror and a plane secondary. It's got a 150mm aperture, that's 6 inches. That puts it on the large side, just on the large side, and it means it's good for nebulas and galaxies. The focal length is 750mm, which is slightly on the short side of things. So put together, that means it's got a focal ratio of 5, and it's more used to darker, larger targets rather than bright, small targets like planets. So what does this mean for the telescope? What I've done is I've gone to a field of view calculator and I've given you a couple of ideas of what targets are going to look like through the eyepieces. Now remember, this is a field of view calculator. It's not about what you're going to see. What you will see is going to be dependent on where you are and how much light pollution there is and stuff. This is just to give you an idea of the size of things. First of all, the moon through the 25mm eyepiece is going to be smallish in the field. It's probably about a third of the way across. 10mm with the 10mm eyepiece, it's going to be quite comfortably in the field. Jupiter, on the other hand, isn't going to be much more than a dot no matter what eyepiece you use. It's going to be very small. It's, like I said before, it's not designed for planets. Nebulas, on the other hand, that's what this guy's all about. I looked at the Rosette Nebula. Now the 25mm eyepiece with the Rosette Nebula on this telescope is just beautiful. It's the perfect field for it. And it really does justify the combination of aperture and focal length. Right, turning to the mount, that's this guy. It's a Saxon AstroSeeker computerised go-to mount. It comes with a hand controller as well as built-in Wi-Fi, which means you can use your phone to control the mount as well. It's an alt-azimuth mount, which means that it goes left and right and up and down, which means it's primarily for viewing, although you can do some lunar or planetary photography as well. So what does this all mean? With the AstroSeeker mount, you're going to have to learn to set it up and align it. With a bit of practice, that's no more than about 5 or 10 minutes work. Because it comes with both Wi-Fi and hand controller, you've got the choice whether to use your phone or the hand box. The advantage of having a Wi-Fi is that you can set it up and control it with your phone. And setting it up actually takes a little bit shorter time with your phone because you don't have to enter the time, date and location. On the other hand, if you want to use the hand box, you're not going to have the problem of your battery running out at 3 o'clock in the morning. Now, because it's an alt-azimuth mount, that means it's designed for viewing or maybe short period astrophotography like the moon or planets where you're less than a second. You're not going to be able to get long exposures out of this thing because you'll get field rotation. And so that's going to prevent you from doing deep space astrophotography. Also remember, if you put a DSLR or heavy equipment on it, you're going to be fairly close to the red line of the weight limit of this relatively light mount, and that's going to upset your tracking a little bit, so you're not going to be able to put a lot of heavy equipment on it. Right, let's unbox it. It's time to move to the floor. We'll change the camera angles and I'm going to spread myself around. Right, I've moved everything down to the floor here. We've got the boxes set out there. I'm going to make a big mess. We're going to unbox all of the components from here into that area there, which is basically what you're going to be doing at home. So let's get into it. I think this is the OTA, the optical tube assembly, so let's find out. Okay. What we've got is a finder scope. Put that there. This is a super 25 millimeter eyepiece. This is a 10 millimeter eyepiece of the same quality. And in here we have that's a finder scope bracket. Over there. This is a Saxon 15075 Newtonian reflector. I'll leave most of the stuff on it for the moment. You can stay there. I think probably in camera shot. Next box. We've got a number of different pieces of instruction. This is the instructions for the mount. And this is the instruction for the telescope itself. Right. These are with the legs, I think. This is a leg brace. That'll be the mount. I'll get that in a second. I think this is packing. Screwdriver and Allen key. This is a compass for the top of the mount. And this is a little brace to attach your hand box to the leg. Finally, the mount. This is the brains of the outfit. Here we have an AstroSeeker. And a SynScan hand box. With its cable. Some more information. This is about the apps, how to get the SynScan app. I think that's all that's in this box. Next, I'm going to go back to the counter and we'll build it next to the counter. Okay, here we are again. It's the next morning, actually. It's time to start building this thing. The first stage of building it is the tripod. And the first thing we need to do is get rid of this. Now, the leg spreader works as two things. First of all, it's a leg brace and keeps the legs nice and straight or equally separated. And it's also a good little thing to be using as a tray. You put your eyepieces and stuff like that in there. Next thing we'd put on is the holster for the handbox. That's if we're using the handbox. And it doesn't want to come out of its little packet. There we go. And that just goes on here like that. It doesn't need to go on too tight because you just put it on the top of the leg spreader there and it just stays. Okay, that's pretty simple. Let's move to the counter now. Right, okay, we're back at the counter now. I've got the tripod here, so we're going to build some bits and pieces. The first thing that has to go on is this mount thing. Now, because the mount is swept back like that, it's a little bit difficult to balance, so it's a little awkward to put on, so just be a little bit careful. There are three screws that go there, and they match up with these screws here. The side camera can probably see that. Let's see, around about there, I think. So the trick with this is to do them up not too tight, and then you jiggle it backwards and forwards to get it in correctly. This has a clutch. Out of the factory, they're a little bit stiff, but this one you can move on its own. The clutch mechanism inside there should help help you or allow you to move it manually. Probably not a good idea to do that while it's actually in motion. I think you'll probably lose your alignment. And then the next thing to do is the telescope itself. I'm going to take the wrapping off this telescope. Okay, I've left these slightly loose so we can move the telescope around inside the rings. It's going to need to be balanced backwards and forwards, and also because this is on its side, the rings are probably going to have to be rotated about 90 degrees or something like that. Let's have a look. Okay, now if I let go of it, it's going to fall backwards. So that means it's too far back. It's a little mirror heavy, but it also needs to be rotated like that. That'll do. We don't have any eyepieces or stuff like that, and we'll be changing that in the future. But let's just clutch that up to make it nice and still. Tighten these up because I don't want to hit in the ground. Okay, I think I'm going to change the camera angles a little bit. I'm just going to get it closer to this thing rather than on the front. Back in a moment. Okay, we're back. Now, the next thing we have to do is attach the hand controller, because I'm going to start with the hand controller. The large half of the hand controller goes into the bottom. By the way, this is the USB type. Let's see that. So that goes in there. And this, I'm going to have to go underneath here. Goes in there. And I've cleverly put the holster around the back there, so I'll put that there. I don't know if you can see it. And I've got some power for this thing. You can run it on with batteries, but I've got a power tank here. So I've got a cable. That goes in there. Right, that is more or less ready for test. I'll show you how the rest of it goes together first, though. Let's see. I'm not going to put this in. This is a little compass. You can put that more or less wherever you like. You can put it up on the scope or up on the top there or down on the mount somewhere. That's up to you. One of the eyepieces. It's the 25. There's the eyepiece in the focuser. Focus works like that, as you can see. Next thing, finder scope. This is a 6x30 finder scope. Fairly basic. That will go into a bracket, which I'm about to build. Now these brackets come with a little rubber band sort of thing. They irritatingly put them around there. That rubber band goes, there's a little notch just in the middle there. The rubber band goes around that notch, and it just allows the adjustment mechanism to do its thing. So let's see, it goes that way, and then with these adjustment knobs withdrawn, you grab the spring here, pull it back, and that way you can put the whole thing in, and it just clicks in there, and you can adjust it like that. Now, how you adjust these things, I've written in a blog. You can go and look at that up separately. And it goes in that foot right there. Okay. I think that's all thing all together. Let us turn it on and see what happens. Okay, it's saying initializing. The version is 043915 in this case. Okay, let's have a quick look. Now, while it's before it's done anything, we can actually test the slewing. Let's see. There you go. Oh, it's nice and quiet too. And up, down. There you go. There you are. The AstroSeeker mount is doing its job. Okay. And then from now, it's simply a case of aligning it in the normal way. I think I'll leave that for today. There's probably other videos to show you how to do that. I'll just reset this and I'll show you how it works with the SynScan app. So I'll be back in a minute. Okay, here we are. I've disconnected the Wi-Fi. As you can see, it's not connected to anything. And I'm going to use my phone to connect it to it this time. Now, the good thing about the phone is it gets all the GPS information from my phone onto the mount, so you don't need to put in time, date, and location. So turn it on. Now, go to settings. Go to settings, and you should find as long as the mount is turned on, it is now, you should find a Wi-Fi in your area called SynScan, followed by some numbers. You may need to disconnect from your home Wi-Fi before you can connect to the SynScan Wi-Fi signal. You can organize that. That's an Apple thing. So once your SynScan app is connected, we can go to the SynScan app. Now the SynScan app comes in two versions. There's a Pro and a vanilla one. I use the vanilla one, there's no problems about that. There it is, SynScan. And it goes to this app, this screen. At the top of the screen, there's a connect button. You just hit the connect button and it's looking for a Wi-Fi. There it is, it's found one. It gives you a little warning saying don't look at the sun. So just get rid of that. Now, with the SynScan app, the default slew speed is 5, and it's that number right in the very middle there. You can increase or decrease that by pressing these buttons here. If I go to 9, that's the one that you can actually see. It's fast. And from there, we can just go normal. All right, and from then you can go alignment, and you can do a 2-star or a brighter star or whatever sort of alignment you need to do. So that's pretty much it. So happy viewing and enjoy your 15075. It's a great telescope for deep sky stuff.